Welcome back to Worldview. Robert Hunziker is a freelance writer for dozens of progressive publications, including our own UK progressive, Z Magazine, In These Times, APOCA, which is the European Project on Ocean Acidification, Occupy Wall Street, Progressive Radio Network, and the Huffington Post. He's an environmental activist and writer who believes one of the biggest problems for the public's understanding of the depth and range of climate change is that knowledge of climate change is based upon statements by scientists, which are, by definition, circumspect, because that's how scientists work. His personal mission is to simplify the problem in essays and articles based upon his research of the science so he can address the horrors of climate change without the circumspection required of scientists, which invariably loses the public's attention and understanding of the severity of the problem. Indeed. Robert Hunziker, welcome to Worldview.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dennis. I appreciate that. I wanted to start by making a public announcement, if you will, and I'd like to nominate somebody for the Personality of the Year for Climate Change in 2012. And that's Professor Richard A. Mueller of Berkeley, the University of California, Berkeley. He founded the Berkeley Earth Science Temperature Project, and a large portion of his funding has come from the Charles Koch Charitable Foundation. He's a very renowned, well-known climate denier. He made the following statement to the public in July of 2012, and I'll quote, 3 years ago, I identified problems in previous climate studies that in my mind threw doubt on the very existence of global warming. Last year, following an intensive research effort involving a dozen scientists, I concluded that global warming was real and that the prior estimates of the rate of warming were correct. I am now going a step further. Humans are almost entirely the cause. That quote comes from an article that was in the Christian Science Monitor dated July 30th, 2012. The title of the article, Prominent Climate Change Denier Now Admits He Was Wrong. The reason I bring this up and the reason I personally wanted to nominate Professor Mueller is I think things like this are extremely important for the public's view and understanding of what's happening with, to get a better understanding of what's happening with global warming slash climate change. Hopefully also it will motivate governments to do something because governments are dead in the water. I've submitted several articles to your publication on climate, probably almost a dozen over the last year. And I coined it a phrase, and that phrase is glacial time is no longer a cushion. And that's a very apt phrase. Glacial time is no longer a cushion. It says a lot. And here's why. Scientists have gone back 15 million years ago, and we have seen instances where glacial time compresses in time, it begins to accelerate rather than happening over a millennium, for example, or a century. We think of glacial time, it compresses into decades. And we're right now, in my view, we've just started a new acceleration in climate change.
Well, you know, speaking of glacial time, we've seen, you know, a lot of talk, particularly with some of the superstorms that we've had, as well as this whole impact of water on the earth. I mean, there was an article just a couple of days ago about predicting that there, just as a result of the climate change and the glacial loss so far, we're looking at a 69-foot increase in tides, which is enough, at least even where I live, to obliterate most of the cliffs here and would put most of Manhattan underwater. Tell me a little bit about the impact of water and what does that mean going forward?
Well, the thing is this, if in fact that were to happen, it would take a period of time, obviously, but you and I'd be in scuba gear right now, is essentially what we're looking at. And, if you look at the crux of the problem, though, I think first let's identify the crux of the problem. And quite frankly, what happened in 1980? What really flipped the switch, if you will, to cause things to accelerate? We need to understand that. What happened in 1980 is China discovered capitalism. State capitalism. And so they've been in the process the last few decades of the largest transformation of a society in the history of mankind. They've transferred several hundred million people, peasant farmers, to urban dwellings. Well, urban dwellers require a lot more energy than peasant farmers. They've done something else. They've also captured the world's basic materials industries. And whether that is cement, glass, chemicals, or steel, they produce these things. And how do they do that? It takes huge amounts of energy. Now, they're using coal. And if you look at the last 10 years, China's CO2 emissions have gone up on an annualized basis by 5 billion metric tons. That's a record for all mankind. They currently emit 30% of worldwide emissions. Now, the problem is this. They're only getting started. They have another couple hundred million people they want to put into urban settings. They've been constructing a new coal-powered plant every 7 to 10 days. Imagine this, over the last 10 years.
I've been watching this for quite some time. I just came back from a 11-day fact-finding tour in China, and their treatment of resources and people and water supply and everything else is abominable. Indeed, we just did a story last week where we were talking about the airpocalypse situation that's been going on for the last 2 weeks. So you're speaking to the choir here in terms of air quality. Yeah. But if you tell me they're only just getting started, that's something to be very worried about.
Well, we know for a fact that they have on the drawing board another 360 coal-fired plants on the drawing boards right now. Wow. Not only that, India has 450 coal-powered power plants on the drawing boards because the Prime Minister has promised their population that he will provide electricity to every home in India within the next X number of years. Now, what happens here? When you have these kind of things happening, is that we've actually thrown ourselves back 15 million years, okay? A team of scientists from UCLA and Cambridge have studied what happened 15 million years ago when the CO2 particles in the atmosphere were 400 to 600 ppm, which is parts per million. Today we're at 393, only 7 off the mark. We've not been over 300 for 800,000 years until the start of the Industrial Revolution. Okay, so what you had, if you take a snapshot of 15 million years ago, is temperatures were 5 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit higher than they are today worldwide. There was no ice on the North Pole, and most of the ice in Greenland and in Antarctica, which are the two big kahunas, if you will, the two massive ice sheets, mostly gone. In fact, they had stunted trees growing on the coastline in Antarctica. Again, you and I would be wearing scuba gear under those circumstances. The problem is that this whole affair is accelerating. It's happening very, very quickly.
Yes.
It's frightening.
But what about that? Why is it that Antarctica doesn't seem to be suffering the same fate? Is it because it tilts away more often from the sun, or why are we not seeing?
I don't know the scientific answer to that, but Antarctica is not as impacted as directly and quickly as the North Pole. I mean, the North Pole will be ice free in 10 years. Yeah. Antarctica, though, if you go to the Western Peninsula, now Dr. Richard Alley, Penn State University, one of the experts on ice in Antarctica, recently conducted an interview that I listened to, and there's definite risk on the Western Peninsula of Antarctica, and it's starting to affect it from the underneath side is the warm ocean currents affect that. They're watching that. They're concerned about that. Meanwhile, they have had icebergs the size of Rhode Island.
Yes, now, I've seen that.
You know, and you've got one now that's manufacturing that'll be the size of Manhattan. Yes. But let's go back a little bit here. Because wherever you go in the world, we've got serious problems. I'm extremely pessimistic looking forward on what's happening to the world. I don't think we can catch up with this. I don't think we can fix it. For example, let's look at water. Go to the Andes in South America. Scientists took photographs of the glaciers in 1983. They took the same photographs today. Half the glaciers are gone. What does that mean? Well, according to the World Bank, you have 100 million people who are threatened because that's their water tower, okay? You can go into the high Andes The sister city to La Paz in Bolivia is El Alto. 1 million people live there. Guess what's happened? Their water pressure has fallen off dramatically. How do you get water for 1 million people if you don't get it from that glacier? Then you can go to the big, big problem, and that's the Tibetan Plateau. It's the water tower for Asia. The Tibetan Plateau, it's the Himalayas, the Pamirs, all these mountain ranges. It's called the third pole. It's called the third pole because it's almost equivalent to the ice you've got in the other two poles. The melting that's taking place there is frightening. Let me give you an example. Chinese scientists have studied the headwaters of the Lankang River, which is known as the Danube of the East. 70% of the glaciers are gone. What happens when the other 30% go? So when you have glaciers that serve as water towers for millions and billions of people, those glaciers do more than just provide drinking water. In the case of China, 80% of the irrigation for their crops comes from glaciers. India, 60% of the glaciers. The same Tibetan Plateau. The Yellow River, the Yangtze River are both also threatened because they've studied the glaciers at the headwaters. They're melting rapidly. The temperatures and in those regions of the Tibetan Plateau are at 50-year highs and staying there. So I'm extraordinarily pessimistic looking forward. Yes,
before we even factor in what we're doing ourselves to the water tables with things like fracturing and hydraulic fracturing for natural gas and chemical runoffs and uranium in the western U.S. deserts. And it just sounds like a very pessimistic situation for us all.
It's pitiful. Yeah. If you look at the oceans, let's look at the oceans for a moment. I don't know how much time we have here.
Just a couple of seconds left here.
Let's look at the oceans. The oceans are, there's acidification taking place in the oceans. You have 9 million species threatened for extinction as we speak. Okay, that's happening. The oceans are going down faster than anywhere else. The coral reefs are threatened. They're the home to 9 million species. State of Washington put out a call to the White House and Congress a couple of years ago because there are 3,000 people off the coast of Washington that depend upon a $270 million a year industry, shellfish. Yeah. They're having problems with the larva making it. They're losing them. And this is a big story. We should spend a good 15 minutes one day talking about the oceans. They're at risk because of too much CO2 emissions absorbed into the oceans. They've absorbed 30% of all the CO2 put into the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution.
And it's only going to get worse as time goes on.
It's a huge crisis. This is... we should spend 2 hours talking about this, I'm telling you, honestly. It's serious. Not enough can be done. I'm not sure we can even fix it.
Well, this has been a very interesting conversation. We've been talking with Robert Hunziker, an environmental journalist and activist, and he's really opened our eyes on a number of issues. Robert, we will definitely have to have you back to discuss this further because much more than we can go into in the time of a normal interview here on Worldview. But thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Dennis.
All right. We'll be back after this.